interesting thing to keep in the history of Kingsport. Please call Brianne Wright or go drop by to see her. Brianne, where are you? Wave at the group. Brianne is our archivist, and she would be delighted to talk with you about anything that you want to donate to the archives. We have some other events through the year. We have one coming up here in Fun Fest. It's a scavenger hunt. If you haven't taken part in that, there are pictures of various architectural places in Kingsport, and you have to go around and find them. So it's a lot of fun. And if any of you are interested in volunteering to help us with that, I'll see one of the people in the room that have got on one of these board member tags, and they'll sign you up to help. Our motive for the archives is where history lives. And history means a lot of things to a lot of different people. If you were at our lecture last fall, you learned about the industry in the Kingsport, Northeast Tennessee area back long ago. Tonight you're going to hear about something that's a little bit more current history. But I'd like to say again, welcome. And Jennifer Hunter is going to introduce our program tonight.
Welcome, everybody.
This is our second annual Gail Hale Lecture Series. Gail was a native of Kingsport. She graduated from Dobbins-Bennett and attended Virginia Intermont and University of Tennessee. She had a catering business for many years, and this was later a successful real estate agent. She was on the board of Friends of the Archives for several years, and several other community organizations. She was married to the late Thomas Fletcher and John Hale, both Kingsport. She had two sons, Thomas Smith and his wife Tracy, and Winfield Smith and his wife Helen. She had four grandchildren, one brother, Andy Taylor, and his wife Susan from Kingsport, and many nieces and nephews, one of which I'm a niece, a proud niece. There's several family members with us here tonight. Her son Tommy is here, her brother Andy, sister-in-law Eleanor, and several nieces and nephews. One of her extended family members is our guest speaker tonight, Robert Gipe. I think a lot of you all know Robert Gipe. He grew up in Kingsport. He was the son of the late Robert Gipe, who worked at Eastman, and Barbara Gipe, who was an RN at Wilson Valley. After graduation from Dobbins-Bennett, he went to Wake Forest and did a graduate at University of Massachusetts with a Master's in American Studies. Robert won the 2015 Weatherford Award for Outstanding Appalachian Novel for his first novel, Trampoline. His second novel, Weed Eater, was published in 2018. And his third novel, Pot, was published in 2021. In 2021, he won the trilogy, Judy Gaines Young Book Award. From 1997 to 2018, Robert directed the Southeast Kentucky Community and Technical College Appalachian Program in Harlan, Kentucky. He's the founding producer of the Higher Ground Community Performance Series and has served as a script consultant for the Hulu series Dope Sick, and a producer on the feature film The Evening Hour. Robert most recently went to all 31 POWs. Every single one in one day. I'm sure you had a very full belly that day. Robert says, the sound of people telling stories is the most precious sound in the world. And that is so true. Robert now resides in Harlan, Kentucky. And we're happy to have him present the second annual Gail Hale Lecture. Thank you.
People ask me, how do you do it?
How do you go to every house in a day? They say, how many are they? I say, 31. They say, when they open? I say, 6 a.m. They say, when do they close? I say, 10 p.m. I say, how do you start? You say, you start on the internet. You get a map. You make a map like your daddy taught you. You decide to go of a Saturday, not a Sunday. We wanted to go of a Sunday because daylight savings time, we thought it'd be nice to end with the sun up. But they close at 9 on Sunday. We went on Saturday. You get in the car, you get your posse. You get Amelia Kirby, you get Will Major from Johnson City, Amelia from Scott County. You go down the Warrior's Path and you stop at the Gate City Pals and you have supper first. And then you go to the River Farm down here outside Dungannon. You start early, you go to Norton and you get there by 6 when they open. In Norton you get a bacon biscuit, a sausage biscuit, a coffee, and a small Dr. Enough. You head to Gate City and you get a butter biscuit and milk. You head to Lynn Garden and you get a gravy biscuit because they got the peanut butter shakes there, you get the peanut butter shake. By 7:15, you roll into Pals number 1, you get your cheddar round, some orange juice, and you think of Gail. You think of your Aunt Gail, who used to laugh and tell funny stories and had always seen the movies that were on at the Fort Henry Mall, and could tell you which ones to go to and which ones to skip. And it was very helpful because for me, it was almost the exact inverse of whatever she told me. She told me to skip most of my favorite movies, and she told me to go that I would enjoy some of the horriblest movies I've ever seen. She gave me my favorite article of clothes, which was a marmot fleece zipper thing that I wore. I almost wore it today, but the zipper's broken. I was afraid it's gonna be cold. She also gave me a puppet of a dragon. It was beautiful dragon puppet. We used to draw names. I think that was the last year we drew names, wasn't it, Tommy? My dragon puppet, I still have it. I think of Gail, and I also think of Miss Bible Williams, my first grade teacher, Miss Jean Lawhorn, and my second grade teacher made me learn all the verses of old Dan Tucker. I'm looking back now, I wish I'd been in Miss Scott's class. They had a kid in there, I don't know who he was, but somebody vomited in there every day. They got to sit out in the hall while I was in Miss Lawhorn's class, helping Brian Woodward cheat on his spelling test and memorizing all the words to old Dan Tucker. I would also note that at the time I had to wear a coonskin cap while I sung to all the older great children. And I had to wear an adult, extra-large coonskin cap in the second grade, and that's why my mother said I was smart. It was so damn big. I remember Miss Frances Reed, mother of Miss Karen Reed, who taught us cursive. And I remember how hard I worked to learn good cursive, because that was one of the sauce burgers I didn't get. It was on my handwriting. Worked so hard to get a 3. No sauce burger and a 2 in effort. No sauce burger. I don't see how you can get, it's too late, I know. I don't see how you can get a 1 in every class you got and get a 2 in effort. If they want me to work harder, they should have made them classes harder. Miss Diane Tony Scruggs, Miss Virginia Dare Collins, I remember them all. They gave me a lot of ones, I got a lot of sauce burgers. 7:23, we hit Brook Circle, which is no longer a circle, but it's still called Brook Circle. And I think if I was a time traveler, I'd like to go back to the beginning of Kingsport. I'm sure it's on paper in here somewhere, and see what it was like for people when they first got circles. Because we just got our first circle in Harlan. They put it in down by the convention center. And it's making people crazy. I'm scared to get in the circle. And everybody's straight on top of the middle of the circle while I'm sitting there. And I was like, you know what? I shouldn't be snotty, because I bet if you go back to 1917 or whatever, when they put the circles in, y'all's people weren't no better at it. Thank you. So we got a ham biscuit at Brooks Circle. Went to Clono Heights, had a Meliella. Went to Pals 31, which is the newest. I'd like to say that there was people that went to every Pals in the day, but they's only 28. And when we was making our map and charting the amount of time it took from one Pals to the next, they added one. They had to shuffle. But Pals 31's the one out there by John B. Dennis. I thought of Watt and how he worked so hard as a young boy to keep that land a farm, and now it's got a Pals on it. So it all worked out. Got a PM extra there, went to Gray and got a Diet Coke. When I went to Gray, you know, it's right by Hales Chapel Road. And Hales Chapel Road, that's where my great-granddaddy built that Hales Chapel Church. That's where our people are from. We're not from here. We're from Washington County. My mother's people, Mr. Hale, and my granddaddy and his three siblings, Aunt Hazel, Aunt Lois, and Uncle James, this was the story we were told. Their daddy didn't work. He worked for the railroad, and then he did. And their mommy sold newspapers, and so I guess that Irwin paper, that was the only work they had. And so those kids, three of them worked while the four of them went to college until they all four got advanced degrees. And my granddaddy got an accounting degree. They went to Milligan. That's where he met Clara, my grandmother. And so then they came here, like back in the day, and he was an accountant for these. It was a melting pot. They lived down there on Oak Street, the twins. And I remember, I wish I'd been my mother's age, because she said they had a wonderful handwriting teacher. And that she said that she'd be teaching them to make those loops. And she'd go push, pull, push, pull, push, pull, push towards the fire station, pull towards the baby end. Which is a restaurant on Center Street. And I remember, y'all remember that, don't you? Did y'all have push, pull, push, pull? Yeah. But they didn't have Pals then. So it was its own reward. So, my grandparents, they were here when I got here, as often the case, and they were living, I remember them living down there in, it's a whatchamacallit, terrace, at the, what are those apartments across from DB called, the Imperial Terrace, that's where I remember, and then I remember all the cigarettes and mirrors they used to have. They had a party house at Manor Court, and it all started in Gray, right up there where the dinosaur bones are. From there we went to Jonesboro. At 8:33 a.m. we were in Jonesboro at a small Frenchie Fry. 8:57 we were at the Johnson City Pals down by ETSU. Got a junior pal burger, which reminded me of my mom going back to college when we were in middle school to make a nurse to pay for our college. We went to that brick Pals they have, which people talk bad about the brick Pals. They just say it looks strange, but I think it's beautiful. And it's yellow. And y'all should go there and patronize it, because they say people think it's unlucky or something. I don't think it is. And then we went to the Bristol Highway one, got a double junior burger with cheese and no onions, went to the Johnson. See, later in my speech, I'm going to recommend that everyone do this. This should not be special. I think it should be an East Tennessee rite of passage. And the only trick in it, if you do it the way we did it, is you got to wait for the mall to open in Johnson City. I'll tell you something else, too. These malls, they're doing their best to keep going, but things have changed. They tore the Sears down. Elizabeth's like, I was making fun of somebody for wanting to leave early so they could get to the Piccadilly before the Baptist today. And Elizabeth goes, you know, the Piccadilly's gone. I said, yeah, I do, but it still was funny. So so when you get to the mall, Johnson City, you can still get into the Pals even though the rest of the mall ain't open, because people are in there walking like they do here. So I have a vanilla milkshake there, and that's where I have my first poop. If you're this is my biggest concern about this whole mission. Because if you know me, if you know my mom, it's a trouble colon kind of group. so it was kind of a loaves and fishes deal. Everybody, oh my God, you must have been so full. We just had like one little item at each place. We carried a cutting board and a cutting knife and cut it up, and we each ate one bite per place, which is how we got through. You know, I was also thinking of, by that point, was Dad. I was thinking of my dad, and I was thinking of Mr. Wilson as we were leaving Kingsport. I mean, I can't tell you, you go to all the Kingsport pals and you take off, and you're off into the unknown. You're, you're going to the rest of the old Big Ten, and you're, but I was thinking of all that basketball, all that baseball we played as little kids. Scott, he's over there. We played a lot of sports together. I was thinking of, because what it made me think of is my dad always got a milkshake. And so I was dreading the milkshakes because they get me. As my mother used to say, oh, they get me. And so we had that milkshake and got through and thought of him and Mr. Wilson, all those church league teams they coached. A lot of us played on those church league teams. Thought about the gym at Old Sevier where a boy whose name will not be named, I've named it before, but I'm not going to name it today, struck me roughly, put me on the floor, and I went to the free throw line, and my mother from the top row of the Old Sevier hollered out in front of everybody, "Don't you hurt my baby." I think it was St. Dominic's Gymnatorium. We played in the Sevier Girls Gym. We played in the later in life, we played in the basement gym at Washington, some of those teams he coached after we were grown. The Boys Club, the Baptist Church Gym. And I tell you what made me think of all this is one year, the Wilsons and my mom and dad went to a costume party. Some of y'all may have been there. They were Goldilocks and the Three Bears. And Mr. Wilson was Papa Bear, and Mrs. Wilson was Mama Bear, and Mom was Baby Bear. Dad was goat. From the John City Mall, we went to Elizabethan, to the Big Pal, and then we went to Irwin, which also made me think about my dad, because his mom lived in Asheville, so we'd go to Irwin a lot to see the ancestral homestead where Aunt Lois and Aunt Hazel still lived. And Dad is something most of y'all know. His dad came here, he had been the manager of a number of W.T. Grant 5 and 10 cent stores, and then he got the job managing the Kingsport 5 and 10 Grant store, which was out there where Kroger used to be, where that Walmart grocery store is out there on Lane Garden Drive. And so, he was a serious man, he was a serious driving instructor. And I was reminded of my brother today as we were kind of driving around that my favorite place on earth, and especially in Kingsport, was Wallace's News. Most of the good behavior of my childhood was a result of a promise of getting to go to Wallace's if I would just, as my mother would say, straighten up. All the baseball cards, all the wrestling magazines, all those Street and Smith's magazines, all the dirty magazines behind the counter, the popcorn, I loved it all. And so it was extremely stressful to learn to drive from my father because he was extremely serious about driving. So we drove down to Wally's, as we called it. We drove down to Wally's and we went in there and whatever, and I came back in the car and he's lectured to me about, you know, keeping my eyes moving, keeping my hands at 10 and 2 on the wheel. What are the other points of the Smith system, Will?
Always leaving out.
You know, he had learned the Smith system from Smith. And so he was very awesome to pass this along. And I'm trying to listen, and I hate to listen. And so it's, I just listen. We're sitting there and so we take off driving, and we're going out to DB, I guess. And so we turn on the center street, right down there by, I always call it those adobe houses. You know, it's like you turn on the center street and there are those houses that look like they'll be in New Mexico or something. And we turn on center street, and and my door flies open. He's been telling me so much stuff that I hated to interrupt him, and I just kind of pulled my door to, but didn't make a noise with it, and drove all the way to Center Street without flinging it open. But anyway, so we turn right on Center Street, and my door flies open, and I turn with both hands and grab it. And I'm up in the front yard of that house in New Mexico. And my dad looks at me and goes, "What did we learn?" I learned he got to drive home that day. But anyway, so we were in Irwin, and we'd get car sick all the time. Speaking of throwing up, we threw up so many times between Irwin and Nashville. Are you youngsters in the room? I think there's some youngsters in the room. There may be someone in here that doesn't remember. It used to be hard to get to Ashley. You guys worked at it. And so I thought of him as we lit out from Irwin, because this is the real unknown territory for me of this past trip. We went from Irwin, cross country, to Greenville, where we got a big chicken, and it was only 12:08, but this is where some of y'all who were following on Facebook saw that. This is where I tried to pay it the first window. I was just getting excited. I don't know what happened. Then if you haven't been to Greenville, to the Pals, they have a Pals in a strip mall. And a very nicely protected bathrooms in the Marshall store right there. See, poop comma second. They got a guard at it, and then a long haul back to it. This is my setup. We got a chip cam there at the Greenville Strip Mall Pals. Jefferson City, hump the Pals. We were dreading two items: a double big pal with bacon, and of course, the real bomb, chip. So we got the double big pal farthest away from base at Jefferson City, the most farthest west Pals there is. I imagine Fulkerson there. You know what I mean? That's as close to Knoxville as Pals get. And so we got the double big pal there, turn towards home, Morristown, half and half tea at Razzie, Morristown by Food City out there, the strawberry shake. 2:55, we hit the Rogersville Pals chili burger. Take it slow. Chili bun at Churchill. And by this point, we had a lot of people following us. People had figured out what was happening. And they were commenting on our post, saying, "Are you all right?" You feel bad because you don't write them back because you're like mission focused. But you're guilty for not being polite because you think of your mother, because you're in her car, which she bought at Toyota Kingsport, without first asking whether the teacup fits in the cup holder. So it's an official Pals mobile. So when Mom needed to stop driving, we took her. I needed to buy a car, which I could have bought, but we told her that I couldn't afford a car, so that I'm still driving that car. And that Avalon she got, that thing still secretes equals. Her tea drink was one sweet tea with three equals. And I swear to goodness, that thing still, equals will still pop out of it. So you hate to not ride people back and let them know what's what when you're out on the road, because you hear her talking to you, so she wants you to say something. You say, "Mom, ghost of Mom. Do the astronauts answer Facebook messages from the moon? Does Dale Earnhardt choose emojis to send to people in the middle of the race? They do not. We will send a lovely note tomorrow," said I to the ghost of my mother. And we went to Stone Drive, and that's where we got Mom's tea, the half and half of three equals. On to Bloomingdale, there it is, right there, it's on the screen. And went to Bloomingdale, and we were fixing to leave Kingsport again. And I was thinking of my time at the Eastman, my scholarship that they gave me to go to college, and I majored in English. And I remember all the Presbyterian fears for my prosperity while I was doing that. Coming home during college, working at Building 190 and 10 Ott with my friends Bear and Moon and Wormy and Wishbone and Hogjaw and Forney and Best Killing Water from Full Blackmore and Herman, Sherman, and Thurman Deans. Ironhead, who was a Banbury operator and would often drop a raw batch of plastics down to the extruder operator he was working with, and then you'd find him in the break shack. I think of Bear and Moon taking me whistle pig hunting and frog gigging, and I remember them talking about how prosperous Kingsport always was, and how even through the 60s, people come in drunk on second shift on Friday night, and they just prop them up at their machines. The only way everybody wasn't going to make money is if those machines stopped. When we were in college, that's when I started, like, had the courage to go to bars with my mother still living. We'd go to the Schleestack Bar. That's what my friend John Pope called it. Ed was there. Because he loved that show Land of the Lost, and they had those pointy wooden things in the bar, like in the Schleestack's cave. We'd get that 10-cent shrimp. And then when I went off to grad school, I'd come back and I worked at Eastman. So Dad had his cancer real bad in his late 50s. He died of that. But I would come back and hang out. I was working on my master's thesis, and I lived here then. I worked with Cleve Parnell. I was a contract writer for the Eastman. I wrote about barcodes. It was the new thing they had at Eastman, barcodes. And they were going to put a barcode on everything they did. And then they just had a little machine would read that barcode. And I kind of broke that story to the rest of Eastman, that this barcode thing was really going to be something. Then we go to Blountville. I got a chili bun, went to Pinnacle and got a sauce burger. And that reminded me of something. One time, I've never told this story because my mom has always been alive here, but the motorcycle gang in Whitesburg, when I lived there, is called the Seventh Sons. And one time, one of the Seventh Sons got up with my friend Tom, my friend Randy Webb, and they were going to go to the drag races at Bristol. And I want to go to the drag races too. And I said, yeah, I'll go to the drag races. Because I thought, this is kind of a rough bunch, but I'm like, the last place I'm going to run into my mother is at the drag races in Bristol. Although, Uncle Johnny, Scott, did you go with us when we went to the drag race and met Miss Sundrop? It was the first beauty queen I'd ever met. She was the official spokesmodel of Sundrop Soda. Were you on that trip? I was thinking, anyway, well, this is the second time I went to the drag races in it was wonderful. We hung out in the pits, or you know, we were down there on the ground. We were in the, when we go with Uncle Johnny, we were in the tower with Miss Sundrop. And, but when I went with the Seven Sons, we were down there right at strip level. And like, it was fun. They would pass dollars. You couldn't hear yourself talk, so everybody was just betting. You want the inside car or the outside car? Outside car or the inside car? And you would just swap dollars back and forth all day, and the tires peeling out, you get rubber all over, little shards of rubber all over your face, and we had deer chili and like a mash tent, you know, like they have on mash, they had their own mash tent. It was very abandoned, communal, and it was extremely close to total freedom, and I just wanted to evoke that. Since we're talking about what needs to be preserved from history. And so after we did the Volunteer Parkway, we had Frenchy Fries, we did the one at Exit 7, Peachy Mellow Yellow. That was an audience request. Someone said, have you tried the Peachy Mellow Yellow, which is a good thing to do on your 29th pal. Gives you a little bump. And on the way to Abington, I thought about my friend Clifford Pierce, who him and Watt and Mom come to see me read in Abington one time. Some of the rest of you did too. Grand Sense Nursery School, Elizabeth, we all remember Clifford. I would often be telling people about Clifford. I remember walking down the street in Knoxville one day, and I was telling somebody a story about Clifford, and he was behind me. And he was working as a clerk at one of the hotels at Marriott down there by Old City, and he got us a room. We ended up getting a room off of him. Another time, Will and Stacy, this is one of my favorites, they were talking about Clifford. And in a department store, Rich in Virginia, and he was the store detective. when we do our plays, we would have community story gatherings in Harlan, an hour and a half from here. And I put an announcement out and people would come. We'd have, if I'd do it with my classes where I'd have kind of a captive audience, we'd have 100 and some people there. And one time Clifford showed up in like flowered shirt and we don't get many flowered shirts in Harlan. And we were sitting at Hardy's the next morning, my magistrate started coming up and campaigning me. Clifford told him this story. I guess I hope none of the other people involved. But he was telling a story that he had been hired, him and some other fellas, to roast a pig. And they got it in the, they got the fire going, they got the pig cut up, and got it in the ground. And then they proceeded to drink all night and pass out. They woke up right before their employer was about to show up. Some of y'all may have ate some of this pig, but the dogs had got into it. And it drug that pig all over the camera. And they were like, well, it'd been in the dirt anyway. And they just put it back together and buried it back. And that man never asked me to vote for him again. So we got a chili bun in Abington, where they did not want a pass. Be too tacky, as my mother would say. I go there every time I pass by. I want that to be the most popular pals in the whole pals kingdom. I want them to choke on the tax dollars. And then we're on our way to our last one. We turn north. We turn north to Lebanon, Virginia, about which I have zero stories. But it's the last pals I ever went to. And going back north, back into the coal fields, I think about my career. I think about working at Apple Shop. I think about all the K-12 teachers that I've done stuff with in Southwest Virginia and Kentucky. I think about helping people write, helping communities write grant proposals and teaching at the community college. And you drift away from Kingsport, and your family dies and disappears, and it's just, I don't have any kin folks here no more. And except for some of these married Indian folks. One of the things I want to tell y'all kind of near closing is it was pretty cool to start seeing Kingsport in reverse. First day I had a job interview in Whitesburg, I was going down to North Carolina to see my then girlfriend at the beach in North Carolina. And I was driving that 74 Superbeetle that Dad got me when I graduated college, so I could drive up to Massachusetts, as they say, to go to grad school. And I'm coming out of St. Paul, and I throw a rod in that beetle, and I had to get towed to Daint. And I'm sitting there in Daint, and this man says, "Where are you from?" And I said, "I'm from Kingsport." And my dad's coming to get it as soon as he gets off the base. And he said, "I would give my left nut for a job at Deason." And I said, "Dad, what do you think Deason would do with your left nut?" And Dane, of course, is where the first person got killed by an elephant. That railroad that the Santa train runs on is the same railroad that took the circus are named Kingsport. Kill the person in Daint. Come to Kingsport. You got the cameras going because this is history now. Elvet, come to Kingsport and kill the person. Now, what my understanding is, these elephants back in those days, teens and 20s of the 20th century, that was a big expense. That's a big part of your inventory of a circus. And so, if you got a bad one, you just changed his papers. You changed his name. This is something that here in the City of Commerce, we can really, you just change his papers. Sell it to some other circus. And so this had happened to this elephant, Mary, a couple, three times. And so, there weren't that many circuses. And so they decided to get that one more payday. And what'd they do? They took it to Irwin and hanged it at the railroad.
Where my people are from.
Also, the other time we do a lot of oral histories, and one of my students was interviewing his papa, his grandfather, and he talked about how this is one dude had a $700 million coal contract with these. And then another friend of mine, her daddy ran a coal company out of a double wide, like where they live. And they didn't even have a secretary, and they had a Big East contract. They'd say the phone would ring, and the kids would be playing and watching TV. They'd say, "Shut up, this thing's." So it's like, really? Although then my other favorite was somebody was telling me I'm down there from Scott County, and back in the early days when they first built Kingsport, there's a lot of rats. They had a lot of rats in Kingsport, so they would start paying $1 a rat for dead rats. And so, like, up in Scott County, they were all going to the Scott County dumps and getting all the rats that they had. And then they bring them down here and sell them, because... Oh, one last one. This is kind of went the other way. Watt's uncle, we were at the hot dog hut. And he was telling us how they used to go up to Everett's, because a lot of those places where I live now, back in the day, 40s and 50s, that's pretty much the same size as here, right? So they were going real fast, so he'd be playing the football. And so he said that at Everett's, they'd sit with a dude could sit with a shotgun in the end zone. And there he is. And there he scored. He'd change it halftime. Of course, that's where the cars came from, right? We were talking about that at Mr. Children's funeral, but they came from Memphis too. So, anyway, we went to Lebanon and got two chocolate shakes, a vanilla shake, a sauce burger, a hot dog, no onion, and a large French fry, because I was starving. I really hadn't eaten anything all day. And then we went over to Lily's parents, the Rich and Bess, and had supper. Pasta and a salad, and it really wasn't that hard. And I personally think it should be a requirement for graduation. I saw in a magazine one time a guy that got the Dollar General logo tattooed over his heart, and I thought I might do that. I might get the Pals logo. But I want to get that one. It's probably come up on there, the Sudden Service one. You remember that one? Looked like a little TV kind of. I put on that Facebook group, has anybody got a picture of that logo? It's the same one they used to stamp our report cards with back in the day. And a woman sent me, and I never remembered this, but it was a 1975 pack of radish seeds that Pals used to give. They used to give out seeds to people, which I think maybe they just did that at Lynn Garden. She was, but anyway. All of this, man, you think about joy, you think about fun, you think about a fest of fun, you think about identity, you think about your grade school changed to be named after Cora Cox, you think about your middle school being changed to be named after your mother. You see in your, here we go, this is a vision, say it with me, you see in your mind football jerseys, brown and orange, Dobbins, Bennett, Sussburgers. The Dobbins, Bennett, Fighting Sussburgers. Kingsport Pitchy Tees. But my favorite, the DB Sudden Servants. You think about these things and your heart brims with joy. We went on this adventure because we needed joy, more than we realized. Saddened by the damage done by floods and storms in our area, disquieted by recent events in our state legislatures and national courts, reductions of rights for queer people, for women, restrictions on teachers teaching American history. That Matthew Hahn story in Central, at Central, that got me, I have to say, for fostering debate in his classrooms. And I thought about Miss Proudmore. I thought about Miss Nancy Proudmore, my debate teacher. I thought about her being asked to go. I thought about Miss Scruggs and Miss Toomey, Coach Crow and Miss Denny, Mr. Fonslow and Bobby Range. Everybody that asked me to consider an opinion other than my own. My favorites, and I wonder how they fare today. You grew up in a world of new cars and bass boats, abundant bowling and miniature golf. You grew up with massive shift change and extravagant fireworks on 4th of July. I grew up with cancer, amid cancer. I was made aware as a child of the responsibilities of prosperity. I remember the first time I heard the story of a trans person, a Kingsport person, when I was 10 and I was taught to live and let live. I lived to see the day that a child can learn on the streets that this is the place once home to Leslie Riddle, the Brownie, and Stick McGee. I lived to see a hometown work with my friend Will Isom in Black and Appalachia to tell more stories of this place. I, who was once called down for cussing at Chuck's Drive-In, we've lived 30 years the child of a Vol in Kentucky, a long lesson of sportsmanship and humility. It continues to this day that I was asked to come home, a home I recognize but barely know, and say a few words in memory of my aunt and really all my people, dead and scattered, and these are they. And I wonder, what could they matter? And think of the Long Island of the host, and my friend Annette's new clap saddle, granddaughter of the principal chief of the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indian, author of the novel, Even As We Breathe. He took me into her home near Koala so I could think about these words and what they would be. And I wonder, can we do better? My heart tells me no, but my heart tells me maybe we can. Maybe we can do better. And maybe if we can do better in the spirit of PAL's sudden service, we can make it fun. Thank you.
Thank you.